look at you, you little death machine.
Guys, we need to talk about redbacks. Put down the flamethrowers, we're opening negotiations. I'm Caitlin Henderson with the She's Got Legs production, a series that turns a spotlight on the misunderstood, the maligned, or the just plain underappreciated organisms doing their part to keep the planet running. This channel is supported by the She's Got Legs Patreon. If you're a patron already, thank you, you're amazing, don't ever change. If you're not, you should absolutely consider joining in the shenanigans. I'll leave a link in the video description. Redback spiders, one of the most universally loathed spiders in Australia, which is saying something. And that is fair, given that they are famous for biting people on the butt, but at the same time, if you didn't sit on them. Can I just apologize to Christy Sanders on Facebook, because I wrote that before you told me about the redback that hitched a ride in your shorts and bit you on the butt anyway. We'll talk more soon about the redback bite and her terrifying miniature fangs. But before we get onto that, I want to do something we normally don't get the chance to do, and that's look at what she does when she's not biting you or eating her husband. So the rest of her life. So let's take a journey inside Castle Redback. Oh, hi. Thanks for inviting us into your web. It looks like garbage, but there's totally order to this somewhere. Redbacks are nocturnal predators, which is why it looks so dark and spooky in here. So let's take a look at the redback web. I have one here. This is our little lady up in her hide. It's the densest part. It's like how you have your bedroom, but then inside you have the burrito you make out of yourself and your doona. Redbacks are not set up for the whole cliche fly catching operation. They are all about stuff that walks along the ground. So they build their webs between two horizontal surfaces, which is why they love our junk so much. So the webs are normally about this size or smaller, but I have seen some that are more than a meter tall. The web, not the spider. They're found naturally in dry habitats, so bushland, savanna, desert, and they build their webs in grass, shrubs, rocks, anywhere sheltered, especially if it can wrap itself around my ankles when I walk through it. The web is incredibly strong and distinctive, and if you ever put your hand through it by accident, you'll be like, yep, that's redback web. They live here now, I guess. The web structure itself is really interesting. We've got this messy top part where she hides during the day and retreats into if she's scared, and then underneath these tension trip lines that come down to the lower surface, and these are covered in a sticky glue, so this part is the actual snare. So here's a millipede having an okay day on his way home from work, looking forward to seeing the wife and kids. There's that glue I was talking about. It's actually a special kind of silk called aggregate silk, but you can call it butt glue. That's fine too. Okay, shh, he's coming. See how she's checking the threads with her legs? That tells her everything. Where the vibration is coming from, how big and heavy it is, if it's prey or if it's a threat. Something really cool about redbacks is their sheer ability to survive. They likely originated in the deserts of South and Western Australia, so they tolerate dry conditions really well, which is something so many spiders just do not vibe with. But they can also go for huge periods of time without food, and we're talking nearly a year. It just boggles the mind. Why would anyone want to do that? But it does mean that they are excellent travelers. They learn the local customs, they try the local food, they've got a guidebook that tells them how to say please and thank you. Once they get to a new location, as long as there's shelter and dirt bugs, they're happy. So we get this situation where they've established around Australia, they're living in and around buildings, they're nicking off overseas to colonize new frontiers and outcompete the locals like the British Empire of spiders. Now that I say it like that, I do not think that this is something we are cool with. So our lady here, she's very methodical. She's not going straight in for the kill. She's glad wrapping that thing with silk first. You can see her pulling it from her spinneret to their back legs. Terrifying. Every Australia's biggest fear. Being swaddled by a pea-sized spider. Now she's snipping that trip line free from the ground using her fangs like scissors. That way she can suspend her prey in the air so it can't escape. It's time for her final vicious attack. She's going in for the, yep, it's okay, keep trying. You'll get your tiny fangs in there somewhere. I believe in you. You can do it.
She's paused here to inject her prey with venom. This does not work fast. This takes a while. And we're heading off to wait for literally hours and clean our feet. That's very important. A spider has to stay hygienic. FYI, this is exactly how I feel when I sit on tall chairs. I have a question here from one of the She's Got Legs Patreon supporters. This is from Scott S. Redback spider populations seem to be concentrated in cities. Is that true of spiders in general, or is there another reason redbacks prefer urban areas? Is it the coffee shops? So it is definitely not the case that spiders in general do well in cities. Many of them have really specific habitats, which we bulldoze our way through to build our buildings. So spiders that live in the soil or in the leaf litter or in the trees, that's all gone now. Where are they going to live? They can't survive in our concrete expanse, but importantly, neither can their prey. So some nocturnal orb weavers, it's been shown that the light pollution really messes up their growth, but equally, light attracts insects. So it does depend on how the spider lives, whether it's going to just straight up die in a city or whether it's going to thrive on our like artificial insect light buffet thing we've got going on. Because of the adaptations I mentioned earlier, redbacks don't necessarily prefer built up areas, but they do survive while there. There is another important thing to think about, which is we're seeing them in buildings because most people aren't out tromping around redback habitat at night. Most people. The major problem with urban redback populations is when there's not much food around, they do buy daily cappuccinos, which drives up coffee prices in the city. I know I'm not going to get out of this without talking about redback bites, so let's address the arachnid in the room before we wrap this up. I was talking to a stranger recently in a shop about spiders, as I do, and he was telling me how much he hates redbacks because one bit him once. And I get that. Once I slammed my hand in a door and it hurt so much that now I only use windows to get in and out of buildings. So I can relate. It's not a fun bite at all. So the thing is, as he told the story, and this happens a lot, I realized it was extremely unlikely that this guy had ever been bitten by a redback. So latrodectism, which is the syndrome caused by the redback venom, actually has quite a specific set of symptoms. It's very painful for hours, and that might be an understatement, but for redback bites, that's going to be the main thing. There's also commonly nausea and like localized sweating, which is super weird, but very distinctive, and other symptoms that get less common as you go down the list. So in this guy's situation, he didn't even see a spider. There was just a sore that suddenly appeared, and the doctor diagnosed it as a redback bite because they're tiny balls of malice and legs. And now for the rest of his life, this guy is going to hate redbacks so much that he probably wouldn't even hire one if it was the best qualified candidate for the position. And that's the kind of discrimination that our society needs to move beyond. And this situation isn't even unusual. In one study of an emergency department in the US, less than 4% of people who turned up with a spider bite ended up actually having been bitten by a spider. And that is huge. That is worth keeping in mind. But redbacks do bite. They're responsible for thousands of bites in Australia per year, apparently. I haven't called them to ask. So these are defensive bites though. So these are not redbacks jumping out of their webs to attack us. These are bites because they are crapping themselves because we've sat on them rudely or a giant hand has come to squash them. So the symptoms of the bite, I've gone through those, and what you might have noticed was missing from the list is dying horribly from spider. And weirdly, that particular symptom has not come up for over 60 years. We thought it was our wonderful antivenom working its magic, but a review of the antivenom did find that it isn't working significantly better than a placebo. So with these guys, the real hero is painkillers. So to summarize, killer redbacks. I would seriously pick something else to worry about. There are so many other things, like lightning strikes and your cat eating you in your sleep. Why worry about the most rare reaction that could possibly happen? If we thought about everything like that, We would never leave the house. We would sit in the corner of a dark room sobbing to ourselves. And honestly, if that's what you want to do, I support you. I relate to that as well. That's it for this episode. Thank you for joining me on this journey into Castle Redback. If you've enjoyed it, hit the follow or subscribe button. There's more good stuff coming your way. And give this video a like because no one ever has enough thumbs. If you've got a few dollars to spare, check out the She's Got Legs Patreon. With our powers combined, we can put the cool back in having no spine. Here's some of our Patreon producers now. Show.